Okay. So, just out of curiosity, right, how many of you went to the iOS conference like 2 months ago? Only a minority, yeah. Okay. Can. So just a brief background behind this talk. I actually gave a short lightning talk version of this at the iOS conference then. So it lasted about 10 minutes or so. So the objective of that talk was to basically show like how is it possible to do BLE localization using beacons such as this, and then of course with our iOS app. Okay, so the lightning talk was a bit short, which I felt that I left out a lot of content in order to meet the tight timeline. So that's why I decided to give this talk again, once more right here. So I'll go into in-depth details about everything you see here. Okay? So before that, let me begin the demo. Okay? I will start with the localization part, but it doesn't seem to work well because one thing, this room is very small, very cramped, and there's a lot of Wi-Fi signals going on around here. So yeah, so okay, the idea here is that if I go closer to this green beacon, for example, right, the cross is supposed to be near there. Okay, looks like near there, right? Yeah, somewhere near there. Then if I go to the cable is not long enough. So when I go to each of these individual points, my iPad should be able to tell the location through the cross there. Okay? Okay, but it doesn't work well here, so assuming that works. Okay, so but anyway, I have another feature here, which is to exert manual control over the lights. So for example, the one on the left, you see here, right, this one? Okay, so let me issue maybe cyan. Is cyan? Yes, cyan. Then I can change the number of LEDs, you can see. Then I can change the brightness levels. Okay, so let's adjust for the rest. This is yellow. A lot. It's purple. Yeah, you can see. Okay, so this talk will be about how everything is being done. Okay, so what's going on here? Okay, so there are essentially three Raspberry Pis. So these are actually all Raspberry Pis here. Raspberry Pi 3s. For the Raspberry Pi 3, they are equipped with Wi-Fi and Bluetooth. Okay. Then it's running on the Raspbian OS. Then each of these Raspberry Pis, they are equipped with something called a unicorn head. So a unicorn head is basically a shield here with an 8x8 RGB LED grid. You can see. Then the manufacturer has provided only a Python library. So the importance of this, I'll come to that. Then I have an iPad mini 2, of course running a Swift app. Then I have my Wi-Fi router over there. Then there are three tripods. So each of these tripods have their own Xiaomi power banks. So that's why you don't see any wires running to all of these Raspberry Pi. They're all independent. Okay, so this is a layout. So I have their layout in an equilateral triangle about 2 meters apart. Actually, I should pass y'all my iPad. Yeah, so y'all can play with it. Y'all can try. Yeah. Okay, so I hope it works, right? Okay, yes, it works. Okay, so they're arranged exactly 2 meters apart from each other. Okay, so this is how things roughly work. So each of these Raspberry Pis, they are actually broadcasting over Bluetooth. Okay, so my iPad app is able to capture all of the Bluetooth packets. And then it will then relay the instructions. So I think I forgot to mention just now, when I walk closer to each of these Raspberry Pis, the closer I am, more LEDs turn on. Then the further I go away, less LEDs turns on. So this is an instruction that's actually issued by the iPad app over Wi-Fi. Okay, so this is how things go on the high level. Okay, so my Swift, there's actually a Swift app running in the Raspberry Pi. Then it will broadcast over Bluetooth. The packets are captured on my iPad app. Then my iPad app will do the necessary calculations and send the instructions of how many LEDs to turn on back to the Raspberry Pi over Wi-Fi. And this is done over UDP. Then, why do I have a Python app? So I come to that. So this is actually sent over, the instructions of how many LEDs to turn on are relayed from the Swift app to the Python app via a Unix domain socket. Then, I will send it to the Unicorn library because the Unicorn library is written in Python. And I'm not going to rewrite the Unicorn library in Swift. So the Unicorn library will then command the RGB LED grid to show how many LEDs you want. Okay, so this is actually where the similarity between my talk here and iOS conference ends, because I'm going to go in greater detail about everything. So let me start with the Raspberry Pi side of things. Okay, so the first, the problem is what operating system do I run on the Raspberry Pi? So by default, the most common operating system on the Raspberry Pi is Raspbian. However, the Swift compiler can only run on the Ubuntu distribution. It cannot run on Raspbian. That was the case before September 2017. Okay? However, another issue. The Unicorn library, the one that powers the RGB LED, can only run on Raspbian. So this is a scenario I face. The Swift compiler insists on using Ubuntu, but the Unicorn library insists on using Raspbian. Then I'm like, what am I going to do? Okay? So instead of trying to force the issue, I thought, is there another way outside the box of the outside Raspberry Pi? And that is, you can actually cross-compile an ARM Swift app on your Mac. This is something that I also didn't realize until quite recently. Okay. However, it only supports up to this old version of Swift, 3.0.2. And you need to actually build this toolchain yourself. Okay. So you need to use this relatively older version, okay, of Swift Package Manager. Then another issue is that you need to I use the Bluetooth library, an independent Bluetooth library that runs, that enables my Swift app to use the Bluetooth stack on Linux. Okay, so let me show you what's so different about this Swift library. Okay, so this is a library I use, okay? So you can see here, this is actually a Swift Bluetooth Linux C helper header. And it requires, for compilation purposes, certain header files have to be placed inside this /usr include directory. So ordinarily, if you compile this on Linux, this shouldn't be a problem. However, if I'm compiling on a Mac, it means that I need to put these files into the usr include directory of my Mac. The thing is, on the Mac, right, this directory is actually protected by the system integrity protection. Where's my slide? Yeah, right here, okay? So in order to actually put files there, I have to first disable the SIP, copy the files there, re-enable my SIP, then compile. So I didn't realize this like until quite late, like how am I going to do that? Yeah, so need something to take note if you want to cross-compile Swift apps. Okay, however, this is not a big issue today because Raspbian is actually supported already. So this is, they support the new one, Swift 3.1.1, not Swift 4 or Swift 3.2. Okay, so the link that you should look out for is actually this one here. So this guy, I think he's an Italian software engineer, he basically compiled, he made some changes to the Swift source code, Swift compiler source code, to enable it to be compiled for the Linux platform. Okay, so you can see here, right, with the release of Raspbian Stretch a few weeks ago, Swift now builds correctly with support for Swift Package Manager, only in September 2017. So why did I face this problem? Because I was actually preparing this presentation before September 2017. That's why I had this issue, but now, no more problem already. The only thing that you need to take note is that you have to install additional dependencies like Python 2.7 and Clang. Because this guy's instruction, I think he forgot that he left it out. Now, when I try to compile his code, got problem. Yeah. Okay, so now the Bluetooth part of things. So, understand that not all of you may be familiar with Bluetooth. So just a quick refresher. So Bluetooth, or BLE, actually stands for Bluetooth Low Energy. There's actually a difference between BLE and the typical Bluetooth classic that we know about. Okay, so BLE was only released in 2010, this spec. Okay, so the another name is called Bluetooth Smart. So compared to traditional Bluetooth, what's the difference? So traditional Bluetooth use it for audio, like headphones or networking purposes, right? So however, the issue is that if you want to use Bluetooth Classic in your iOS app, the other device must be certified by Apple through this program, made for iPod, iPhone, iPad certification. But for BLE devices, you don't need to go through this certification process. Okay, so what's so special about BLE is that, as the name suggests, low energy, right, it's designed for those that require long battery life. So things like a heart rate monitor, thermometer, and fitness trackers. And there's also a secondary purpose, which is for things like location tracking, which is actually similar to what I'm trying to do. Okay, so how do you broadcast Bluetooth from R5? On iOS, you can use the core Bluetooth stack, but there is no core Bluetooth stack on Linux for Swift. So that's why I use external library. So the previous one I showed you, where is it? I think it was, yeah, here. This is actually the helper headers. The actual library is actually this one, Bluetooth Linux. So you can see here, pure Swift Bluetooth stack for Linux. Communicates directly with the Linux kernel. So this library actually uses the C headers here. Okay? So Okay, so there are some limitations on iOS called Bluetooth. So there's no easy way to uniquely identify all of these devices. So why do I need to do that? Because I need to do localization. I need to uniquely identify that this particular packet comes from this Raspberry Pi, another packet comes from that Raspberry Pi, another one comes from this, another Raspberry Pi. Okay, so the easiest way to do it, in fact, the conventional way of doing it is through MAC addresses. Right, all Bluetooth devices have a unique MAC address, like your network cables, your network NIC cards. Okay, but on the iOS, there's no API to get that. Not without using private APIs. So the way to get around this is I embed the MAC address into the device names. Okay. Did I show? Yes, here. Okay. So if let's say if we were to do a scan with an example app called Light Blue. So Light Blue is basically a Bluetooth app that lets you scan devices. You can actually see that I identify my Raspberry Pi to be all this. B539B3. So what I basically do is that I take my Swift app inside will access what is the Bluetooth MAC address and then take the last two letters and inject it into the name. So in this case, my iOS app is able to uniquely identify them already. Okay. In order to change the name, right, there is no Bluetooth API for that. You need to use this tool like HCI config. This is actually a Linux program. Just set it down the Bluetooth interface and up the Bluetooth interface. Then the Linux OS will broadcast already on this new device name. Then, okay, so now I come to the iOS part of things. Okay, so how do I actually get that? Okay, so the key thing I need to get is RSSI, or it stands for Receive Signal Strength Indicator. Okay. So how do you actually do it, right? Okay, so to do it, you just import core Bluetooth. Then your class, you just implement the CB Central Manager Delegate. Okay, so the first thing to do is actually to scan for devices, or basically look for devices. So this is actually the API to call for. Okay, so I notice that I initialize this CB Central Manager, and I call the function. And the important thing is actually this one here. Okay, so this one, a CB Central Manager scan option allow duplicates key should be set to true for my application, because the default is false. So when it is false, the iOS will only send the first advertisement packet to my app, and subsequent packets are ignored. But when I set it to true, basically my app is telling iOS to give me all the packets. As it comes, just give me. Don't just give me the first one. Okay. So where is the part that I receive the packets? Here. Here. Yeah. So this is a delegate function. I did discover, advertisement data. Okay. So the RSSI is actually given here. So this delegate function is called repeatedly. Whenever iOS gets an advertisement packet, this delegate function is called, and I get the RSSI. Then I can do something about it already. Okay, so what can I do with the RSSI? So there is actually a relationship between the RSSI and the distance. So it's actually governed by this formula. RSSI is equal to minus 10 times some propagation constant times some log distance plus some decibel minima and 1 meter. So what are all these? So propagation constant is really a constant of 2. So it means that the signal will degrade by 2 units every certain distance. Then there's also a reference transmit power. So this is a reference transmit power at 1 meter from the source. For the Raspberry Pi 3, the value is minus 60. So the reason why you need this is, let me give you an analogy. It's like trying to know how far your friend is based on how loud your friend is talking. But in order to do that, you need to know how loud your friend is in the first place. So this is what it means by the decibel milliwatt at 1 meter reference. Okay, so what I do, just make the distance the subject of the formula, then substitute all the relevant values in. So from here on, I just need to plug in the RSSI value and I get the distance. Okay, so this is the theoretical way of doing it. But in practice, right, RSSI values fluctuate wildly. So the reason why I couldn't do this demo here, because in my initial test, right, is because of many interferences in the room. One thing, the room is very small, so signals get reflected. So I cannot get the distance well. Another thing is Bluetooth uses the same frequency as Wi-Fi, 2.4 GHz. So if your Wi-Fi signal is very strong, you also can interfere with the Bluetooth. Yeah, so couldn't work well. But I think those who went to the conference, I think you realize it actually worked well there. Right, because at Nanyang Polytechnic, right, I'm quite far from the rest of the audience, and there's no 3G signals or many signals in the room. Okay, so the way to solve this, right, my first attempt was to try to average the last few values. So what I did, I implemented a fixed queue. Okay, sorry, I implemented a fixed queue. Basically, I have a first in, first out queue that is limited to the last 10 values. Then I will average up the values that I receive. So in this case, the average is 1.8 meters. However, the problem is that certain values will be very, can be very high, can be very low. So basically, they are outlier values and they'll affect the final value that I get. So one way is, another way I thought of was, why not I just try to find out what are these outlier values and then drop them. So this is my next attempt to use a technique called a trim mean. So again, I collect all the values in a fixed queue. I sort the values. And then I drop the top and bottom 20%, and I average the rest. So this means that this values here does not adversely affect the final average value, which is probably what I want. Okay, then what to do with that? So with the distances to the three beacons, right? And then I know where the three beacons are. I can able to know where I am. There's this algorithm called the trilateration algorithm. So basically, you plug in the values, you solve the simultaneous equation, you can get your location already. So I shall not go into detail about this lah, just Google it. Okay, so now the next one, drawing the UI. So you probably see this all these fields lah. So what I have here is actually a master UI view. So my colleague Peru, actually she suggested to me this way. Because initially I thought, why not just try to like put them directly on the what do you call the main view, controller view or something? The main view. Yeah, then I find that it's very hard to like to relative place them relatively. So I just put a single square, yeah, then it's easier for me to place all the UI views lah. Then all these circles, right, they indicate the distances from the beacon. Okay? Okay. Okay, so the problem, the first problem I ran into was I'm very used to Cartesian coordinates. So Cartesian coordinates is this lah. So X positive, Y positive here. But for iOS, they do it this way. X positive here, Y positive here. So, I find this a bit headache. So, I decided why not I just try to remap things. Okay, so the first issue that I faced was I calculate everything in meters. But obviously, when you place things, you place them in pixels. So, I had this ratio for every meter. Basically, the position changes by 50 pixels. Okay, then I did some remapping lah. So to map the X axis, I just add half a width to compensate for it. Then for the Y axis, because the Y axis is on iOS downwards is positive, but on Cartesian coordinate downwards is negative. So basically I need to add a half width and invert it. Okay, so I just hope later, I'm wondering if anyone has a better way of doing this way. Okay, so now I go on to the sending and receiving. So the communication between the iOS app and the Raspberry Pi is through UDP. So why UDP? Because I don't really care. Once I send, I just fire and forget. I don't need to maintain the session, right? If the packets get dropped, never mind. Not important. So the way I use it is, I use something called the IBM BlueSocket library. So the reason I use this library is because it's really, really cross-platform. It works on iOS, it works on Mac, it works on Linux. Yeah, okay. So never mind, I just continue. So what it sends, basically it sends a number of LEDs to turn on and the color values. Okay, then for the Swift to Python side of things. So I need to relay the information from my Swift app to my Python app on the Raspberry Pi. Okay, so how to do it? The conventional way is probably to use network ports, right? But network ports, although they work, I thought that maybe is there something more specialized. There's actually something called a Unix domain socket. So I'm not sure how many of you are familiar with it. So this is basically an intro. So it's a form of inter-process streaming communication. Only for Mac OS and Linux. Windows does not have this. So the properties is reliable. Whatever you send through the socket is guaranteed to be received on the other side. And it's sequential. You send in this order, you get in the same order on the other side. And secure. When you send, the Linux kernel will guarantee that no other process will be able to touch or able to see what is being sent, unless you are the root user. Now that's a different story. So of course you cannot say the same for network protocols. This is not, all these three properties are not true for network protocols. Okay, so what, how to do it is actually you need to set a socket path. Then you write and receive to that path. This is done by both my Swift app and the Python app on the Raspberry Pi. And the good thing about this socket path is that it can be secured by Unix permissions. This is not true for network ports. So basically, if you don't have read and write access to this particular socket path, you cannot do anything with it really. Okay, so how to send? So again, I use this IBM Blue Socket library. So this library is very powerful. You can do UDP, TCP, and then Unix domain sockets. So you can see, actually, Unix domain sockets is actually a streaming protocol. You can see the word stream here. Okay? Okay, then next. Then on the Python side of things, I just basically listen to packets. Okay? Yeah. Okay, so what about turning on the required number LEDs? I use the Unicorn library. So what I do is that I iterate through all the LEDs grid here. So basically the library, what it does is that it gives you the API to set the color for each individual pixel. Okay, so I need to iterate through them. So on my iOS app, I will set a number to be number of LEDs to be turned on to the RPI. So with this number, I need to know which row and which column, which LED to turn on. So I just use this formula. So if X times Y is smaller than number turned on, I turn on LED. Yeah. Okay, so this is not hard. Okay. Then from the RPI to the Unicorn head, how does the things actually work? Okay, so I understand not all of you are hardware people, so I just go through a brief intro. So they use the communication between the RPI and the shield is through a pin called PWM or pulse width modulation. Okay, so there's actually a dedicated PWM pin on the Raspberry Pi, which is this one. BCM18. Okay, so PWM basically means that you can try to generate an analog value using a digital signal by quickly varying the number of times you turn on, the ratio of number of times you turn on, ratio to, compared to the ratio of number of times you turn off. So you can generate a pseudo analog signal. And so this is how the Unicorn head actually receives the instructions. Okay, I think that's, I'm quite near the end already. So what this project has done, what have I learned from this project? So the thing is, I gained a greater appreciation of localization. Sorry, still got time. Okay. Okay, so imagine when you use like Google Maps or your Grab and Uber, right? So things just work, right? GPS just works, but how do they actually work? So in this project, I've learned really, this is actually very close to what they actually do. Your GPS satellites, they get three of them, you're able to know where you are. Then I combine many technologies, really a lot, like Bluetooth, Swift on iOS, Swift on Raspberry Pi, Python, UDP, Unix sockets, and many hardware stuff. And finally, I've finally given a talk I wanted to give at the iOS conference. Okay, so yes, that's all. Any questions?
Yes. What's the ideal size that you're trying? Like, this is too small. What's the size that you would prefer to use? Like 10 meters.
Okay, 10 meters is the absolute maximum. Okay, because for Bluetooth range is 10 meters, really just 10 meters. For I think for class 1 or class 2 device. Anything further than that, you need a more powerful Bluetooth transmitter. Yeah. Is that quite, do I have more time? Or?
No, yeah, you have about 6 minutes. Yeah.
Okay, so any other questions? Okay.
Why did you choose a queue for gathering RSSI?
Okay.
A queue of length 10.
Okay.
Try out any other values for the queue.
Okay. So the rate of sending, I program it once every 100 milliseconds. Okay. So about 10 per second. So okay. That's why I felt that a 1 second interval is the most appropriate for this. If I increase the length of the queue, right, the data will be quite out of date for my existing position.
Okay.
Okay, any more questions? Okay, then that's thanks all of you.
Thank you. So that was Kheng Meng